Growing up should be all about friendships.
You think Mighty Mouse could beat up Superman? What are you, cracked?
First kisses.
That was great.
And finding yourself, right? But for increasing numbers of kids, Hollywood has failed to deliver.
Post-COVID, kids are having trouble going back into society, outside their families, back to school, and are presenting with distress and anxiety to health professionals.
The number of drug prescriptions doled out to kids to treat anxiety and panic disorders have more than doubled in the last decade. The biggest spike coming last year with a 42% increase over 12 months in prescriptions. Experts say those pharmaceuticals should usually be the final option.
So what it really reflects is lack of access to good psychological and behavioural care. Clearly, we have a very long way to go to meet the real needs of children in this country.
Changing attitudes are also contributing to the uptake. Kids are becoming increasingly well-versed in mental health vernacular, and experts say parents are increasingly ready to listen.
Simply being able to use those psychological terms doesn't necessarily mean that you've got a mental disorder or a psychological disorder, and certainly not one that requires necessarily medical treatment.
Creating a generation of young Australians unable to cope unmedicated.
We saw this in adults previously in Australia in the 1990s and 2000s, and now in children. So what happens if you don't have good access to psychological care and behavioural care, then rates of prescribing go up.
Joining us now to discuss the issue is world-renowned youth mental health expert Professor Pat McGorry. Pat, how have we got here?
Well, this is something, Georgie, we predicted this at the beginning of the pandemic. We would see a 30% rise in mental health conditions in young people in this age group. Not really children, teenagers and young adults is the key risk group. And so this rise in prescriptions is just really a symptom. It's just a reflection of that genuine rise in need for care amongst these young people.
Kids have huge feelings. I have three boys and their feelings are big. How do we know the difference between just regular emotions versus mental illness?
The way we know that is because of objective community mental health surveys based on interview methodology, where people have gone into the community. The latest was in 2021, and we saw a 50% rise in diagnosable mental illness in the community. This is not just, you know, the stresses and strains of growing up and just, as you say, the turbulence of adolescence. It's not that. It's absolutely not that. This is a genuine need for care.
Is it a good thing or a bad thing that kids are so familiar with the language around psychology?
I think it's a very good thing. When I was growing up, you would not be able to recognise it and even worse, talk about it with anybody. So this is a very good thing. I know in the newspaper article that's triggered this story, there are some people trying to, once again, blame young people for a lack of resilience in this space. And I just think that's typical of the whole of human history, where young people have been blamed for the problems that they actually experience.
When you look at this across the nation, beyond just the single snapshot of some statistics, how big do you think this problem actually is?
Well, when you think about it, it's the number one health crisis facing Australia at the moment, in my opinion. You're looking at a whole generation of young people. Two out of five are currently diagnosable with a mental health condition. And these are the young people that are heading towards productive adult life, and their health is being undermined by, you know, an unprecedented rise in mental health conditions.
When we're looking for solutions to this crisis, what role does medication play?
Well, medication is part of the answer, but it's not the first port of call. Obviously, engaging and talking to a young person and providing psychological and social forms of support and therapy is what we always prefer to do. But there's definitely a subset of young people that benefit greatly from medication, and so it's part of the therapeutic response. But we really need to understand also the causes of this global mental health crisis.
Professor Pat McGorry, as always, thank you for your thoughts on this.
Thanks very much.
It's a tough one, isn't it? As a parent, the first port of call, you're not going to race to medicating your children. Mm-hmm. So I think that, you know, what's being said about so many kids on medication, parents aren't going to be just putting their kids on there
and
for no reason.
Do you reckon this point that's being made today about the lack of access to psychologists is part of what's going on?
Oh, it's huge. You can't just have one without the other. It should be both.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's this huge demand, but again, as we're seeing across Australia when it comes to adults, but now following a suit with kids, you just cannot get into the people who are going to help you.
The wait lists are huge and people just give up.
Yeah.